and thank you to you guys, because, I mean, without your vision, we wouldn't have had the early childhood center in the first place. And it's, I think it's a great place, so.
This community needs it. Yeah. I don't think we could do without it. Yeah. So, it's essential. And thank you, Rich.
Thank you.
So I just threw up some talking points as a reminder that this is considered a zero year across the entire state, all districts, but especially ours. We're just learning the process. We're learning about the rubrics. Building leadership teams are starting to evaluate where they are in the process and understanding the process. We're putting BLTs into place, and those building leadership teams are developing plans. Our district leadership team is our curriculum council, and now finally the last couple meetings they're starting to get educated on what their role will be. That's been really fun because some members of the district curriculum council are on building leadership teams and some are not, and I think that's really important because the purpose of this accreditation system isn't just for a few people to make decisions. It's really for everyone to understand the process and understand what plans are in place and what's developed. Building site councils are active, and the district site council will meet one time this year. I'm planning that, and I'm really nervous about that, but I have a plan in place, and at quarter four board meeting, I'll report to you on how that went, and I will actually probably invite you all to that meeting as well. And then new to the little abbreviation process is OBT, and they started out saying that was going to be the outside validation team, but they've changed that to outside visitation team now. This team really just visits your district, gets an update on the process and progress you're making towards your district goals, provides feedback, and then ultimately they'll make a recommendation to the state as to whether or not you're making progress and should be accredited. So it's a visitation team, not a validation.
Is it made of laymen, or you go visit other schools, they come visit you?
So it will be a combination of teachers, administrators. For example, if we become part of the Kansas MTSS process, then it could be the MTSS team, the state team could be on that. I was visiting at the last training I went to with Dodge and Liberal, and we said, you know, it's kind of crazy to have a member, because they want similar schools to be your team members, but you can't have anyone from your district on your visiting team, obviously. But, you know, you hate to have a person from Dodge, a person from Great Bend, a person from Liberal, all making these road trips. So I think the state is going to say, you know, you can have a couple team members from Dodge, a couple from this district, and kind of pool your resources. But we have some teachers in our district that are interested in being visitation team members. They're going to get trained on that. We're encouraging it because I think if you become a visitation team member for another district, you will have a different perspective of the process, and that could only benefit our district as well.
How do they apply for that? Are they chosen?
We've had about three teachers in our district interested so far. And our leadership team is just putting the parameters that they can only be an OBT member for one district, so that way they're not out all the time of their classroom. But we have a huge amount applying, we're not going to deny very many people that opportunity.
Who pays for their training and travel and all?
The training is free, and most of that will be in sublet, so it won't be overnight.
But the travel when they go to other schools, who pays for that?
Right, that's in our discussion. We're going to grant them the professional day to do that, but the travel is up in the air at this point. Probably be on their own. Let's see what else. At the end of this school year, we're hoping the district leadership team will be have enough information brought to them that they can maybe go to Dr. Carlin and the leadership team that meets on Mondays with him and make a recommendation as to what stage in the process we want to be. We could start at the baseline year, which would be give us all 5 years to go through the process, or we might be ready for year two or year three. But right now we're gathering information from all the building leadership teams, looking for common goals, and then we'll make that decision. A good example, again, is when I was visiting with Dodge. They're starting new leadership in their district with a new superintendent, so they already know they want to start year one and go through the whole five-year cycle. In visiting with Dr. Carlin, our board goals, we're in year three, four of those, and so we might really want to align our KISA goals to fit board goals, and that might help us decide a little bit more where we are. Any questions? I feel really good about where we are. The last district leadership team meeting, we got through about half of the buildings sharing out what the building leadership teams were focusing on. And I was really nervous that it would be all over the place and then how would we really choose a focus for our district. Very common. A lot of things on building culture, a lot of things on continuing rigor. I felt really good about that. So, any questions? All right, I'll give you a quarter four update, probably May.
Thank you. Walker and Dernalis. And we got Dee Jones, she's a math coach in Cooper and Georgia Matthews. And we got Desiree Delahant, she's a fifth grade teacher at Charles Stone. Kelly and I, you're going to have to quit. And she is a first grade teacher at PEO.
Yep.
And then we got Amber Doyle, second, third grade Luke at A.P. Hubert. Regan McGraw, she's an instructional coach, so has been a literacy coach and been taking on the math piece of it this year. The Edson, he is the math coach at Buffalo Jones, and
Dee Sherman.
And then we have two visitors kind of on your dish. You've probably seen in the back. You know Melissa Hancock? She's a math consultant we're working with through our project Achieve Grant, and then we also have Sherry Martini. She's part of that grant as well. They're here all week for part of that, doing classroom observations and coaching. So, any questions? Good?
Okay, again, I'm Diane Houston, and it's good to be here. We were asked to give the school board and others an update on where we are with the math curriculum. I'd kind of like to start with Dr. Martin Luther King. He said, if you can't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. If you can't walk, crawl. But whatever you do, keep moving forward. And I believe that's where we are with our math curriculum. And we're constantly endeavoring to move forward. Sometimes the pace is different depending on the challenges that we face as we try to do that. So a little background. We started with a pilot about 4 years ago, and then we've had year one. We adopted Engage, or we didn't quite adopt it, but we went with Engage New York / Eureka for kindergarten through sixth grade. And in doing that, we established established a framework based on the Engage / Eureka curriculum. All that we did, we got from our curriculum. And we utilized this, we utilized Engage for all it was worth. We wanted to see what it had to offer us. And again, we found out through growing pains and listening to teachers, educators, parents, the community, how we could make it better to become our own. In the year two, we brought, because we did those things, we listened, we made modifications, or we created modifications to support the needs of our district, our teachers, and our students. Within those modifications, we had parameters, so we wouldn't go too far out. We introduced customizing to our teachers so that they could have more buy-in or control over their what they were teaching. Our pacing guides were adjusted. Again, as we found out the struggles through the pacing, the kindergarten teachers came to us with, as Mr. Guyman mentioned and Andrea, the higher level of rigor in the curriculum was new to us because we had mostly that procedural rather than conceptual understanding being taught. So the kindergarten teachers came to us and we adjusted their curriculum to begin the year with a boot camp, which we took the lessons from the preschool or readiness Engage so that they would be kind of ease into a transitional curriculum to be ready or more ready for that first module at the curriculum level or kindergarten level. So year three, here we are with year three. We, again, with what was modified in, or what was done in year two, we built on that for year three. So we added a district common assessment, and that actually came from the school board asking us to see what our kids are learning through that instruction. We better adjusted the pacing guide based on our writers of our curriculum and their suggestions by combining and omitting some lessons. And because we had more time with our contact days and making those adjustments in the pacing, we were able to add some problem-solving days with a variety of problem-solving tasks. And then we had flex days, so teachers could have some opportunity to create and add to the math curriculum. So, and we're excited about moving into year four. Again, always trying to move forward, always trying to get better, and always trying to become the curriculum that fits our district and our needs. Thank you.
So with the, we really focused on professional development this year as far as our teachers, and we focused on as far as implementing the curriculum, so professional development within Engage New York, and the professional development also as well as building teachers' capacity to offer, you know, solid foundational mathematical teaching, and then to build their comfort with the standards and the curriculum and what was kind of rolling up. So these are just some of the things we have done at the beginning of every year, as well as this year we did an introduction to Engage New York for new teachers. So our new teachers coming in haven't seen the curriculum. If they hadn't, it's been in a pre-service setting. So it's a half-day training. All new teachers come. We walk them through all the components of Engage New York, our frameworks, our protocols, and then the things that we've learned along the way that they'll know starting off. Preparation and customization. This was provided last year for the whole district, so these were kind of checkup breakout sessions, so teachers that have been to it before but wanted a refresher could come to it, and then we all of our new teachers came to this as well because they haven't been through that training. We've got, as math coaches, as far as PD for us, we're all members of the Kansas Math Leaders group, and they have webinars or monthly meetings in different places, and we just attended those via webinars. So we're updated on all the changes with the state, and then they offer different PD that we can in turn bring to our teachers. KATM, which is the conference, the state math conference, we had several attend, and then we also had several presenters, which was really exciting. So we had a couple teachers go and present how they're using problem solving within their teaching, and then we had a talk about student literacy and discussion. So we've had several presenters that we're proud of. And then with the Summer Academy, we had the Summer Project team. Melissa's been coming every other month. And so within that, we wanted to do some support for principals, since they're the instructional leaders of their building. So we've come in and provided support for them. So that was a half-day training. They came in and we talked about what good math instruction should look like. So when they're walking in, what should they see? Is this, you know, should they see this? Should they see that? So that was support for our principals. Coaches also attended that as well, since they're doing walkthroughs. And again, we, at the beginning of the year, we did kind of a presentation over the Summer Academy. So we did that, and throughout this year, there's been follow-up of those participants, observations and coaching, and then also even teachers who didn't attend that directly are filling the benefit of it. Melissa's attending PLCs and working with the coaches, so they're able to benefit from some of that. We've got several teacher-led book studies going on, which is super exciting. Coaches are leading these as well, but several of our buildings are without a math coach this year, and many of them have taken on leading these studies on their own, and then some of them with coaches have also taken that on. Those are just two of the books that are being done right now. The developing or mastering the basic facts, so moving beyond the memorization, that's a K, probably goes K-8, K-6, and then our 6 through 8, teachers have been doing a book study on understanding ratios and proportions, which is their major cluster for those three grade levels, and that's all being led by teachers that attended the academy, so that's really exciting. We had the second annual math summit with John Sangiovanni. Again, we did training with the principals and the coaches. Again, what sound math instruction looked like, and we talked about productive and unproductive beliefs and how that affects the way we see mathematics and how you know, it can actually harm our students or help our students. And then in the afternoon, we brought the teachers in, some of the teachers in, they did a little bit of that, and we also talked about some techniques they could use to encourage persevering and productive beliefs for math from the students. We did a solving word problems using tape diagrams training. We actually, several of our buildings, and it's all fifth grade and up, basically do not have a math instructional coach. So they really expressed, I mean, that was a great need. They were really hurting without having that support. And so we looked at several different options, trying to be innovative on how we could get them support. They had virtual coaching offered through Eureka, lots of different options. But this was the option that we felt like we'd get the most bang for our buck and the ones that teachers were asking about. So we brought in a Eureka trainer. They went over solving word problems with tape diagrams. So they walked, and we did, this is focus 6 through 8, so we walked our teachers through how solving word problems with tape diagrams looked from kindergarten all the way up to their level. So the feedback we were getting from the teachers is, I have this curriculum, I know it's in sixth grade, but I'm having a hard time understanding. These kids are coming up with these strategies that I'm not familiar with, I'm not comfortable with, I can't help them build on that. So this training really helped them see what the kids are coming up, how this curriculum is building, and then they can use that within their instruction. So we heard lots of good feedback from that. Sangiovanni, Dr. John Sangiovanni, and he is a current member of NCTM on the board. So he's the one that led our summit, and then he also came back and did training with our teachers. So our summit was based on more mindset and productive and unproductive beliefs and what good instruction looks like, and then the second time he came in, we focused on fluency activities and things teachers can start using right away within our curriculum, so things they can take away and start using right away. So we focused on fact fluency, what that looks like, the K through 6 level, and how to incorporate that in what we're already doing. And then the same thing with secondary, and that the focus more on there was identifying areas kids are struggling in and how can I build that in. Because, you know, in our higher level curriculums, the curriculum's assuming, or the standards are assuming that they've mastered that. So how can we build that in to make sure that they continue with that fluency or build that? This is coming up, but I went on ahead and put it on there. So we've done the customization and preparation training. K-6, 7 and 8 have had it, but they really felt like they needed more. They were still struggling with the customization and preparation. And what that means is you're taking the manual or the module, and it's not intended for you to teach every single thing, every single problem, not every single thing, and that's supposed to be completed. So the preparation and customization process walks you through looking at your assessment and then going from there. I'm teaching these components, I'm teaching this part, my kids are really going to struggle with this, so I need to add this in. So it walks them through that process. Again, we've done it with K through 6 and also 7, 8, but they were really struggling with it. So there's a training. It's kind of the same thing we did with our Eureka trainer. We brought them in and then opened it up for smaller districts to come in because the cost is higher. They've done the same. They're bringing the exact same trainer back to Winfield, and then we're able to send a couple of our middle school teachers to that. That is next week, I believe.
Do you know what the expenses for those trainers are?
To bring a Eureka trainer in for one day is $5,200. It's very pricey. Because we wanted to bring them in for 2 days, and, you know, not possible. So the buildings that didn't have the coach helped split that, and then we paid a portion of it at the ESC. And then to help cover some of that cost, we opened it up. So the teachers that attended their district paid us a small fee, and then they're doing the same for us when we're going there. So that helps out. They have lots of different ones. Those are just the two of them. They do a major work of the grade span, which I think would be, it's basically looking at 3 or 4 grade levels, the progression of how they're learning. So taking those progressions and really working through that process, it's a lot. And so that's really a good one, too. We wanted something the teachers could turn around and use the next day. There's a whole lot of background knowledge, and it's going to be time to process it and figure out how you can implement that in the classroom. So this was our teachers, you know, have their aha's and get started right away. So we've done a lot. It's been really exciting. I've heard lots of positive feedback on the support we're giving, the time we're taking out to them. Any questions?
I have just one question. So has all this changed from year one when we started? Because you keep talking about, you know, the teachers are struggling, we need to keep training them. I mean, are things changing every year that they're still not getting it? Or?
No. I think it's just continued support. So as they're getting deeper and deeper and deeper in the curriculum, things are coming up that before we didn't even know was a problem. You know, like the preparation and customization, when we didn't know that was even really something we should be doing the first year. So after that first year, we found it out and we've, you know, moved forward with that. So our PD is, I guess, kind of based on what our teachers are asking for. You know, we have a lot of new teachers every year, so they need back to the, you know, year one of training because they haven't had the last 2 years. So just kind of based on what our kids are needing and what our teachers are needing. And then as far as our upper level or, let's say, secondary or maybe intermediate center, what the support they're needing looks a little different because their kids, they have a little different. You know, our K-3 students right now have had this for 3 years. So the holes, the misconceptions, those things aren't, you know, that we haven't seen them as much as, you know, older level kids who jumped in midway. So the support they need at different people's levels are different.
May I add, Mr. Cruz, our first PLCs, that very first year, were basically towards that curriculum and learning the curriculum. Our PLCs are much different now. We're building on what we learned. So it's a process. We're just getting better and better at it.
I'm sorry. You mentioned those kids in the upper level that were kind of in that gap where they started in the middle of their elementary career. How are you filling those in and adapting that?
Well, part of that was the teacher support, you know, the tape diagrams. So our curriculum is a lot of modeling, a lot of tape diagrams. So then we're getting into 7th and 8th grade and the curriculum's, you know, using
right.
And teachers, kids were coming up using them. Teachers didn't know
right.
What they were, how they meant. So training our teachers on that. And then as far as filling the holes with our kids, some of that fluency pieces, so building that in. You know, so when you start identifying the holes those kids have, how do we do that? Because our curriculum, so we'll have to either look at past lessons or past years or bringing in resources And we have some, I'll share with you in just a minute, ways to start disaggregating the data a little more so we can identify specific standards or misconceptions and we can really target at that. Okay.
Crystal mentioned the district common assessment that was done. I'm just going to take a few minutes and talk to you about the process, the moment that, and then the findings. So the request was to provide something that showed growth or success other than some of the other things that we were doing with kind of the testing already. And so what we came up with was taking one of the end module assessments, which was already being done in the grade levels. So each grade level was asked to do a certain module, and then they would have already been doing the end, and then we had them do a pretest. So for that unit or that module, they did a pretest and a post-test. And what we did was we met with each of the teachers and the coaches did and took a PLC and took time to talk about going through the test and grading and using the rubrics that are provided, and was actually a nice way for us to all district-wide, first through sixth, get on the same page with the rubrics and the tests and to answer questions or to talk to each other about what we're seeing, things like that. And then from there, we collected the data for every kid first through sixth grade. So the numbers that I'm putting on this slide are just simple things that I kind of chose to share, but I have an Excel of first through sixth with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and thousands of pieces of data on it. So it's kind of compiled into one. And so what the percentages show you is I took the average score of all the pretests district-wide first grade and all the scores of all the post-tests and then gave a percentage of improvement. So first grade across the entire district on average went up the 44%, and then second through sixth. So every grade level showed at least 26% of an increase, which obviously first grade showing a massive increase, but basically it also opened the eyes to teachers because the end module assessments, especially when we started, were frustrating. And so it was nice for them to see the pre and the post and to see what they're able to do, which was in a lot of cases not much of anything on the pretest, to then see the post test and have them be able to go back and grade and have tons of success and then have us be able to sit down and have discussions about what they were doing that correlated to the success. So the district common assessment was a nice talking piece and also provided the data that we were looking for.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say a module, this is just a lesson. So like one lesson out of the...
A module is like a unit.
Right.
So a unit could be anywhere from 15 to 30, some of them are to 45 lessons.
Okay.
So the tests that we use for these, depending on the module, could have been anywhere from, like I said, maybe 15 to 30 lessons, something like that. So it was, they had to do, between the pre and the post test, was a lot of lessons and days and learning. So it took a number of weeks from pre to the post, and then we'd meet, you know, at least once in there, and then we met at the end of grade nine.
And this data is for last year's school year? Is that what you said?
No, this was the beginning of this year.
This year.
It was this year. Yep, we did this in the fall.
Things in perspective, like the fifth graders, those are the ones who have been with at least Common Core, not necessarily Engage New York, but Common Core their entire educational career.
Well, they would have been in first grade.
Huh?
They would have been in first grade, right?
This is their third year with it.
So the third year
no, I mean, with Common Core, just in general, with the implementation of Common Core, not necessarily Engage New York.
I know that.
Oh,
that's right.
So, so then, which grade level has only known Engage New York?
First, second, and third.
Okay.
I take that back. Third grade did not have any kindergarten in their first year with them.
But there are some sixth graders who have been with it at least since probably at least third, right? So, but they've had.
I think most of these things have already been discussed a little bit, but I'll just kind of go over it really quick. Our pacing guide and our flex days that we give the teachers, it's their guide of sort of what day they should be on what module, what lesson, approximately. So we've made it, well, I guess last year we heard that and we found that they couldn't get through all the modules they were supposed to. And so that's why we started looking at customizing the pacing guide. So we looked at research on the standards and how they could be, lessons could be either combined or eliminated if they weren't in the major clusters of the standards. So that's what we did, and we did that for every grade as far as that goes. And so now, with that extra time, like Diana said earlier, we have more time for flex days, like if there's state assessments and they need to be doing assessments and they have some extra days to do things, they have more days to do reteaching, they have days to do remediation, well, that's reteaching. They have, like we have Ames Web testing days, and some of the things we heard were, oh, we haven't taught that yet, you know, it wasn't in the module yet, so now sometimes they're more aligned with even Ames Web and state testing. So, let's see, I think that's all about the flexible, as far as in the combining and eliminating lessons. The kindergarten boot camp, I don't know if you heard of that, but we also heard from kindergarten teachers that it was kind of tough to jump right into Engage New York for those kindergartners, and so we took some lessons, 2 weeks worth. We called that the boot camp, and they came from Engage New York pre-K curriculum, and so a lot of the teachers opted, it was a choice, they opted to use it because they thought it was a good transition into the regular kindergarten curriculum. So that's what that is. If there's anything else, I think that's about all.
I'll jump in. Customized pacing guide or the compacted pacing guide. So we were getting a lot of feedback from teachers saying this is going too fast. You know, I can't. I need to slow down. I need to remediate. This pace is too fast. So we really looked at the number of lessons opposed to the number of days that we had in school, and then went through the modules and looking at, you know, if it was a major cluster. So this is a huge foundational skill. We left that in, but several different. Objectives are called additional, so like 10% of their understanding should be based on that. So let's say they had, you know, five lessons, they all had the same objective. So we combined some of those, we put some of those together. So we worked through every grade level, every module, kind of combining, maybe eliminating, and we have documented, you know, reasons why this was eliminated, why this was combined. And then that gave them what we called flex days. So basically extra days at the end, or that they can, you know, put throughout whenever they needed them, so they could take those days and not feel like I am behind. So it gave them flexibility with their pacing to adjust as needed for their kids. And then another thing we were running into, again, was we weren't getting through all the curriculum, which was an issue before, you know, before I engaged New York, and I taught 11 years, and I never got to my, you know, last module. It just never happened. So this allowed them time to get to that. It kind of, I guess it's secured that we were getting to some of those modules that were important, that maybe we were getting left off just based on time. So this was this came from feedback from teachers feeling rushed, feeling pressured, not feeling like they have time to do these things, which are important. Kind of gave them kind of a, okay, I can do this, I have time, you know, I can just sit here. If I have to take 2 days here, it's okay, I have that flexibility. So just giving teachers some of that flexibility and not feeling so stringent on the lessons, which they had before, but I think knowing I have that flexibility, but if I don't do it, I'm going to get behind. You know, that keeps some of us from sticking on track. But this kind of gave them that wiggle room. We're still going to get through it. We're going to be okay. So that kind of derived from teacher feedback and how we can make that fit our kiddos.
I have a question. So there's still like guidelines.
We like a suggested pacing guide, which is more like a quick check for them. So if it's the middle of October and I'm still on module one, they should be module three, like something's going on. Like, you know, I need to really look at how, you know, my pacing or how I'm teaching. So that's more of a, to keep them just kind of on track. It's not intended for me to come in and say it's the 24th day of school, you're not on this lesson, you're not on track. Like, that's not the intention at all. So it's just kind of a check to keep the teachers, to keep them on pace and to assure that we're getting through the major part of that curriculum.
So that they can get through it in the amount of instructional days that we have as well. That guideline can help them. But it's like Crystal said, we don't, you know, if you're on not the exact day, I don't even think we say the exact day. We just say this time to this time, you should be doing module one, whatever.
So. And that's good, because some years you'll have kids that'll, they'll have a classroom that'll speak through things.
Approximately 8 weeks, this should take approximately, that's been built into when Gage New York suggests how many days for how many lessons. So that we've had that in place, and again, that's just been kind of a check for teachers to make sure they're on track and not getting super far behind, again, not to the day. The compacted pacing guide, the things I were talking about, is a little more specific for a resource for teachers to say, I can combine these three lessons, you know, I can eliminate these two, so to give them that extra. You know, because I think our curriculum had more days than our school year. So,
yes.
You know, we didn't want, you know, so we wanted to build that into our school year and again, give them the flexibility where they can, if they need to take more,